Thank you for joining today's session. My name is Jyoti Chaudhary, and I am the Senior School Counselor of Salwan Public School, Gurugram. Today, we are presenting the first webinar of the series of programs on parental well-being. The entire world is going through a stressful period due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The virus is known to spread rapidly and bring harm to the human respiratory system. Our daily life is in turmoil. The global pandemic has had a detrimental effect on the world's economy as well. During this time of heightened anxiety, we know that you or a loved one may need someone to talk to. To help us navigate these uncertain times, we have amongst us today Dr. Samir Parekh, an MS psychiatrist, to discuss ways of addressing anxieties and stress. Dr. Samir Parekh has played a significant role in enhancing the image and reach of mental health across the country. He completed his MBBS and MD in psychiatry from Civil Hospital, Ahmedabad, and topped the university in both. From 2001 to 2012, he set up and led the mental health department at Max Healthcare. In May 2012, Dr. Parekh moved with the team of 18 experts to set up the Southeast Asia's largest comprehensive mental health program, Fortis National Mental Health Program, that has over 75 experts in NCR, the services in Jaipur, Mohali, Ludhiana, Amritsar, Mumbai, Bengaluru, and Kolkata. I can go on and on with Sir's introduction. Dr. Parekh, a very warm welcome to you on behalf of the entire Salwan fraternity.
Thank you.
We also welcome our Honorable Principal Ma'am, Ms. Rashmi Malik, an educationist who believes in self-awareness, self-analysis, and deeds which combine spirituality and practicality. I request you, ma'am, to share the vision of conducting the web series for the parental well-being.
Good afternoon, everyone, and good afternoon, Dr. Parekh, and a warm welcome to Salwan family, we should say. The times are pretty challenging, and you must be, overloaded with a lot of work, and we are really, really thankful and honored, to have you here for this session for our parents. Now, I'll give you a brief background to this. We all know that the lockdown happened, in March, and everybody was actually, the first, I think, as psychologists also, that the first response was shock in every human being around, right? So we all were in shock. And at that time, when we talk about the school scenario, we had our classes going on, before the lockdown, and the news was spreading about the corona and all that. And then suddenly the lockdown happened, and every child was sitting at home, and there were no results, etc. So what we did as team, as many other schools also did the same, that they focused on what is to be done now. This is a challenge which has come now, what to do. So we all geared up, we all had a lot of training, and we fortunately got this Zoom platform, and everybody jumped the bandwagon, and we all started. So we all trained ourselves, we trained the other stakeholders, that is our parents also, we trained our children also. And in this entire process, 15 to 20 days went by, wherein that shock got absorbed. We were all in shock, but then we got, diverted into this entire processing and planning things. And after that, what happened when it became a routine, then this fear started coming back again. And the stress also started building up. So we were like talking to each other during a meeting with the counselor also. And then we realized that there must be something which is not very good, because I was getting feedback from the class teachers wherein children are a bit stressed at that time. So we thought that we'll do a survey. So we did a survey of, the stress. And as we are a school of 2,800 plus kids here, around we got responses from, I think, 2,400 or 2,500 parents, right? And what we found out was that 8% out of them said that they are highly stressed, even after a month. Okay? They were not able to understand what is to be done. then 50% of them, they said, okay, we are stressed, but to a certain extent. The alarming thing was the depression which was setting in. So 6%, that is, I'm talking about like 15 days back, we had the survey. 6% said that they are depressed. There was another 6% who said that the family relationship has become a challenge. And then there was obviously financial loss and the business and job losses there. So there is stress, there is fear. And on the top of it, many of them, I'm sure these were the ladies who said that they are not able to manage their household work. So we decided that let's, you know, handhold the parents. And because as teachers, you know, we are all busy 24/7 and we are able to manage our stress and all. But the other stakeholders who are really responsible right now for academics also of the child. So we thought, let's handhold. And that's where Dr. Jyoti told me that, okay, let's call Dr. Parekh. And I'm really thankful to Fortis Healthcare also that, you know, you all are really, really, you know, standing with Sylvan Schools for, I've seen now for 3 years, I mean, I'm seeing the involvement, the kind
of association.
The kind of commitment your professionals have is amazing. And thank you so much for coming here. And I'm really looking forward to, you know, some solutions, which I'm sure you'll be giving to the parents, you know, because ultimately it is our future generation, you know, who's supposed to be comfortable, whether at home or on online classes or in the school, whenever they come back. And looking forward to your session, and over to you, Dr. Parekh. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rashmi ma'am. Dr. Saab, now please, can you please throw some light through the lens of psychiatry on strategies to manage mental and emotional wellness under our current circumstances? Sir, please.
I think what we need to understand, and picking up from what you were saying, what is a fact? Let's look at facts. We were not prepared. To be honest, we are still not prepared. Because the sheer intensity of what we are facing in terms of COVID is unimaginable. It's unprecedented, it was unexpected, it came with a full force, it impacted us in a way that we have never imagined. We are all, in one way or the other, related to the field of education, whether it is parents, teachers, counselors, as a mental health professional myself, we haven't read about this. We've had no training about this. We have a distant memory about some flu happening in 1800s, 1900s, but we really did not anticipate something like this could actually happen. So whenever something of this magnitude, this intensity happens, of course we'll experience stress and anxiety. And we'll take our own time to be able to adapt to it depending upon our circumstances and various other aspects of it. Let me start with this entire thing about online classes first. I've had a very clear opinion from day one. I'm very much in favor of online classes. But let me also make it very, very clear why I am. And since we have parents and teachers and administrators all here, so I'll tell you why I like the idea of online classes during a lockdown. What did not matter to me was the academic component of it. Because let's accept it, neither the teachers nor the students nor any of us were prepared to get into pure academics out of the blue on a tele IT platform where we can't always see children, so on and so forth. And let's accept it. It wasn't going to be easy. And more importantly, a certain percentage of children would have always struggled infrastructure-wise, bandwidth of the internet. I mean, there are various components which you don't know. But the reason why I was in favor of online classes was because it brought routine in children's lives. Because you didn't want them to wake up in the morning whenever, or to start their day in a listless, dull way, not knowing what to do. It brought routine to them. What it also did was, which is the most important aspect, they got to see their friends. They got to see their teachers. So the social connectedness, the peer interaction during those times when we were stuck in our homes would make a huge impact in bringing a sense of normalcy, which is the third reason why I wanted children to be in online classes, because you would still feel, in spite of what is happening, there is a perception of normalcy, which would prevent children from experiencing unnecessary anxiety, because anxiety was in the air. And yes, then we had our own adult component. We were worried about finances, jobs, work from home strategies, trying to look at work and home, balancing and everything, not knowing what's going to happen, constantly looking at news and numbers, all of these playing on our minds. So it was natural to experience anxiety. The key anxieties that people talked about, one was, what if I get the illness? Second was, how do I deal with the uncertain future? Third was, how do I deal with this whole new way of living, which earlier was lockdown, now it is partial. So how do I deal with it? So let's look at each of this. How do you deal with the anxiety of the illness? There is only one way to do it: preventive methods. We have to be responsible for our own selves. We follow rules 100 out of 100. There is no 99.9 out of 100. No, you do not go in crowded places. You go only when it is required. If you can manage from working from home, you do that. You always wear a mask. You always maintain a distance. You always do sanitization. You follow all those principles. Once you do that, your mind starts feeling the confidence that, yeah, you know, I'm taking care as much as I can, so the anxiety becomes less. It's very similar to, let's say, a diabetic patient who knows that I need to be regular with my medication, but I also need to take care of my diet and exercise. If I take care of my diet and exercise, diabetes will not grow. So you start feeling relaxed about it and not very tense about it. But this can happen if you do it 100 on 100 and you involve children at all levels. You educate them, make them understand the importance of it. Although my personal opinion on this is that children have been easiest to deal with. I think all of us adults have actually thought that children didn't deal with it well. I think it's quite the reverse. They've kind of enjoyed this in their own sweet way. And they got more mobile time, more internet time. They got to stay at home. And what better? Now you wake up in the home, at your home, and you at your own will open your laptop or phone and get to see your teacher. And I mean, how much can she scold you online? So, children have handled, we have shown us the mirror of how to deal with stress when it comes to children's ability. When it comes to the uncertainty of the future is uncertain. Fact. We do not know how the next 3 weeks are going to be. So what do? You can't keep thinking about something that you don't know what's going to happen. There's only one way to deal with it. Here and now, one day at a time, live in the present moment. How do you live in the present moment? Focus on only three things: productivity, positivity, connectivity. Stay productive. Now, productivity does not mean only work. Productivity also means doing your household work. In fact, for all you parents, involve children in household work. We may be surprised, but they actually like doing it. Just don't push them. Let them enjoy the process, but make them do it also. Then comes positivity. There is so much negativity all around us. We need to bring it down by instilling positivity. I think our default option of reading a tweet and criticizing, reading a Facebook post and criticizing, seeing something on WhatsApp and criticizing, that's almost become a default post. I mean, come on, if you can't praise it, don't criticize. That negativity keeps circulating in the air. You don't want it there. There is so much good that happens. Surely we can find that. Think about it. From where do children learn words which are really not taught by your English or Hindi language teacher? From us. From where do they learn aggression? From us. So what do you do? What you do is you become better role models. You and I, all of us. And the role models who are there need to be more responsible. The social media narrative needs to be positive. I am the last person who's going to say, don't give children phones and don't let them go on social media. You say it to them and they'll think you've come from planet Jupiter. There's no point saying things to them that they're not going to follow. I'll give you an example here for all of you, especially parents and teachers. We do summer internship every year for grade 11, grade 12 psychology students. And this year we almost thought of not doing it. And then we started getting a few requests from counselors, teachers, and children. And we said, okay, let's give it a try. And typically I don't take these because they are happening at our different hospitals across India. So we thought, well, I had time, they had time. So I thought, let me do it. I take the whole internship myself. And I was overwhelmed. I was overwhelmed because our first batch was what, 4,500 kids? And I was forced to do the second batch, and another 4,000 kids. Then I was forced to do the third batch. In total, we did 13,500 kids right? And as a part of this, I told them, let's do a social media project, kuch positive karte, impact lagte. And my challenge to them was that, can we touch 25 lakh lives? Can we make posts on mental health awareness and reach 25 lakh people? And guess what? They reached 50 lakh people in 3 weeks. And while I was teaching them psychology, so I got a question. Sir, we want to learn sports psychology. So we did an internship in sports psychology. Then, sir, we want arts therapy. We did an arts therapy one. Then some young people said, we have heard about fashion and psychology. So we did one on fashion and psychology. Then they said, we want to learn about school psychology. So I think day after tomorrow, we have a 2-day internship on school psychology. Then they said that, well, you know, sir, we've done so much on social media. Why about you want to do something in the real world also? I said, fine. So they forced me to do a 7-part series on pro-social peer moderator, which I'm starting, I think, probably the next week or so. Even I don't remember the dates because they made me work so much that I have forgotten everything. And, you know, I stopped following a lot of people on Twitter because I started following these children now. It's so positive. They write poetry, they write blogs, they write such immensely compassionate, positive messages, and much rather follow children than adults. And that's the impact that is what is needed. So rather than saying, don't do this, how about do it positively? And they'll show you the way, you trust him. So positivity, productivity, connectivity. Stay connected. Make children talk to grandparents, your distant cousins, your extended relatives. That's what is the core strength of a society. Our DNA made togetherness. Right? That's what we are. You know, it's who we are. Families is who we are. So anytime when people told me that, you know, spending too much time with family, what is too much time with family? As more as possible. I mean, come on, that's what you do everything for. And then let's come to the third one. How do you deal with the new normal? You deal with the new normal, understanding that it's a new normal for a short span in time. So even if you are going out of your comfort zone, so be it. If you are working from home, bring structure, work-life balance, create a workstation. In your non-work time, do other things. Don't let it spill over. Your burnout will not happen. Do lots of video interactions, but maintain a healthy lifestyle by keeping your wake-up time fixed. Do a bit of exercise, hydrate yourself well, eat well, listen to some music, do some arts, do some creativity, play a lot of board games with children, do a lot of family time, let meals be family time, let television be family time, pick up some old postcards, ask your grandparents to talk about stories from their times, build that bond up. I mean, a lot of people have been telling me they've reconnected with their school friends, their alumni. This is the time. We are now realizing that we were never alone. Urban loneliness was because we got too busy for our own relationships. I think COVID has taught us a lot. COVID taught us minimalistic living is possible. COVID taught us we can take care of our own selves. COVID taught us that we can actually live with our family and have a brilliant day. COVID also taught us that we can also invest into our own selves in terms of newer learnings, creativity. You know, one of my colleagues has started sketching, somebody's doing painting, some start seeing all sorts of things possible. But most importantly, COVID taught us that we are interdependent. If I take care of me and you take care of you, COVID stops. If I am irresponsible or you are irresponsible, we give each other COVID. That's the reality. So what do? You bring compassion out of your closet. You bring empathy out of your closet. You bring collectivism out of your closet. And then let's be altruistic. Do things for others and let children learn that. What have we done in the last 2 decades? We took away children's water, their green, their planet, their air. We broke rules. We gave them a world which are only marks and grades, which typically didn't have any meaning. And now it's time for us to bring the second version of mankind. You know, COVID should be a trainer. I mean, I've always believed adversity should teach us. And there is a lot of teaching opportunity here. So if we pick that teaching opportunity, create a path where, you know, young people can learn from us for a change in a positive way. That's the learning. That's how you move forward. Some of the other things that you need to do is, if you are stressed, you talk to someone. Let children learn that talking to someone is a good thing to do. It could be your family friend, it could be your colleague, a junior, a senior, a cousin, a parent. But when they see you not bottling up and talking, they'll also learn to speak. So you unmute yourself. Create a space where children can talk to you without any hesitation on whatever it is. And rather than reprimanding them and criticizing them or being prescriptive, facilitate a self-change so that they never have the hesitation to talk to you. Use teaching moments in life. If some trigger has happened in the society, it could be a trigger on social media of some people chatting with each other. Use it as a teaching moment. See how your child feels. Tell your child, let your child develop empathy and social responsibility. You read something about bullying or trolling, use that as a teaching opportunity. You listen to something on the news, use it as a teaching opportunity. And you encourage children to develop a whole personality beyond academics. If I look back at my schooling years, then two of the biggest impacts on my life was my Hindi teacher and my bio teacher. Hindi teacher, because my Hindi teacher convinced me and talked to me about being a public speaker. Identified that I had that skill. And today, if I look back at my career, my Hindi teacher made the difference, because from grade 7, I've been speaking and speaking thanks to Mr. Bhaskar. And my bio teacher, and I'm a medical student, so you might think my bio teacher taught me bio. Of course he did. Mr. Miranda did. But you know what he taught me? Don't stop playing your guitar. Don't stop playing cricket even on exam days. What he taught me was, if you balance your life, you'll succeed. So if you encourage that component of life, where life is a complete, then that's how you take it forward. For all of you who want to read more, we've just penned down a book that is How to Keep Your Mind Fit During a Pandemic. It's a free e-reader, thanks to the generosity of Rupa Publications. Go to Amazon, click it, download it, read it, lots of tips for you, and feel free to send me your comments and questions. Social media is a place where people's attention span is even lower than what it is at any other place. So typically what I do on engagements like this, I speak for a short time so that I can take more questions. So what we'll now do is, I'm open for questions. Feel free. If you have anything to ask, comment, say, suggest. We're all learners here. Feel free to ask.
Thank you, sir, for such an enlightening session. We will go ahead and take some questions now. The first question which is coming up is, sir, how to prepare children to face challenges in life?
I think what one needs to do is, there are two aspects to this. One is, children will keep observing how do we face challenges. So if I get frustrated, I get irritated, I get angry, I get rattled, I get overstressed, children feel that may be one way to do it. That's one side of it, which is the observation. The other side is where the school's role also comes, which means building resilience. So schools need to invest time in building life skills that gives children resilience. So for example, how do you manage struggle? By talking to others, by help seeking, by building your skills, your communication, social skills, problem solving, creativity. All of these build resilience. They allow you to fight the stress that comes to you. That's how you become an expert in challenging situations.
That's nice. Right, sir. So second question is, how can we make work and family balance in this long COVID effect?
I think COVID makes it even more easier. If you are at home, then 40, 45 minutes of calm, 15 minutes of family. 45 minutes of calm, 15 minutes of family. But create a work window. Before and after, there should be no work. I think all of us need to start doing it. My honest suggestion, learn to switch off your mobile phone. Try calling me after 7. It's switched off. Right? I don't take calls after 7. Over the years, I will realize that there isn't any other way to do it. Because as long as you are on, something or the other will keep on happening. And as young people say, FOMO, I don't think there's anything like FOMO. You will, what do you miss out? What do you miss out during your sleep? The world is going to be right where you left it. We have to create a balance by valuing your free time. If you see it as a waste, then you'll not be able to manage it. But if you see it as a part of your productivity, you'll be able to manage it, because you'll be better productive if you're unwinding better.
Yes, sir. So the third question is, in midst of these online classes, how to develop a liking for studies as children have started taking it as a burden after half an hour? This is what one of the parents is asking.
My honest answer is that there should be not more than 4 classes in a day, and there should not be more than 45 minutes per session, in which 30 minutes of academics is more than enough. Because I don't think beyond that is really possible to be able to manage, both for the teacher as well. And let's be fair on the teacher. It's not that the teacher has been trained into how to do an online classes for years. I mean, we've just suddenly switched it on. I'd be quite okay even if children lose a bit of interest. I would be quite worried about it. It's okay. It doesn't matter.
Yes, sir. So another question is, in these hours of arrest situation, house arrest situations, how to keep moral high of parents as well as children?
Don't call it a house arrest. The moment you use the word arrest, it has a negative connotation.
That's a negative word.
I don't see them as walls. I see them as a fortress. A fortress that you have created to prevent an invisible enemy from entering your home. See positively. You bring both the generations together. Do things that both generations like. Take time out for yourself also. Bring some fun. Bring some enjoyment. If you have younger children at home, let your bedroom and your bed become a football ground, and don't worry about the things breaking down here and there.
So another question is, I want to know about the key or mantra to forget all the worries and focus on today. It may be due to stress and time, less time management of this thing, but what should we do to overcome it?
If you actually focus on today and do not think about a distant future, right now in COVID times, you'll be able to manage it. So what you do is avoid reading too much of data. Don't try to Google about the illness. Don't try to do anything which is beyond your role. Just keep yourself updated enough to know what care you need to do. Indulge in connectivity. If you just don't give yourself too much of off time where you are thinking, procrastinating or brooding. Divide your day with multiple things, which should include social engagement, which is connecting through using digital mediums. Family time, which can be a combination of television, board games, meal times, just chit-chat, gossip time, some play time. Put all of that together. Take time out for some creative hobbies of your own self. And the work that you do. Do some physical activity. Do some relaxation, pranayama, meditation as well. Listen to music. Put all of this together. You won't have time to think.
Right, sir. So another question is, sometimes even after giving multiple instructions to the children, they do not work accordingly.
That's okay. That's normal. That's a child. Don't give multiple instructions. Ek baar mein sunaya to panchmi chhathi baar mein sunne ka koi chance hai nahi actually. So, and in any case, children, if you tell them a thing two, three times, so unko lagta hai ki nagging kar rahe. And nagging is always ineffective. I think do's and do nots ko thoda kam rakhe.
Right.
Absolutely important. Otherwise, not.
So another question is, how to identify children if they are under any kind of stress?
Be sensitive. If they are going through a change, which could be sleep appetite patterns, it could be performance academically, it could be hesitation in meeting people, it could be mood shifts, being more irritable, cranky, or not feeling very happy. Not talking to friends, not being able to enjoy, not liking to go out, not liking to have fun. So if you see any of these changes happening in them, then that might be a red flag. It's a good idea to explore it one-on-one and let the child speak.
Taken, sir. Sir, I think this is the last question. How to deal with increased conflicts at home?
See, how do you resolve conflicts? You resolve conflicts when you are not rigid. You resolve conflicts when you don't start by a narcissistic approach that says, I am the only right. You resolve conflicts by open, honest, transparent communication, by active listening, by being willing to walk a few steps beyond your stance so that you are able to find a common ground. As a parent, if you are a person who is able to resolve your conflicts well, you'll be a fantastic role model for your child. And a happy family, a family that spends good quality time together, parents, grandparents, cousins all together, there is robust evidence to suggest that children will grow with better sense of self, more cohesive sense of self, and they'll be much happier in happier families.
So it looks like that we have covered all the questions. I would request Rashmi Madam to say a few words.
Jyoti, there are two more questions which I can see here. And yes, one question is that, do you feel that lockdown has taught us to be patient and introspect ourselves? I think the answer is an affirmative. And the other person has asked that children have started becoming little careless because of partial lockdown. How to ensure the safety in this case?
My honest careless as much as adults I see. So when I come from my home to my hospital and I see people not wearing masks, not keeping social distance, I feel so disappointed in adults that, you know, your irresponsibility is going to affect my fraternity of healthcare workers. It's going to affect our families and our senior citizens and children. I find it just so unfair and wrong when I see irresponsibility in people. When I talk to children, you know, it's very, very rare that I need to tell a child to be more careful. You know, if you give the space for a child to understand why, how, what, they're able to do that. But you also then give equal stimulation, more space. So taking something away as a rule, you need to give them something that occupies them. So both things you need to do.
Yeah. So I just wanted to apprise you, we recently started an activity with our kids. And we have told them that just imagine that your school is about to open in 15 days. Then what are the SOPs which you would like to create for yourself? So, you know, they're coming up with all these instructions automatically. And in the process, they are learning about all these things. There was one thing which you talked about, that there should not be more than 3 to 4 classes in a day, and which we are following at the school. And because we have taken this, challenging times as an opportunity to create independent learners, which has been our dream for years. You know, the children are now becoming independent learners because of the flipped learning concept which we are using inside the school. So this is something which we are taking care of. And the last thing which I would like to discuss about, which I would like to, you know, talk to you about is instructions which the parents were saying, that you said that don't give too many instructions. I would like to add one more thing. I have seen that we usually, you know, give instruction to the children as if they are our slaves. You know, we become authoritative. So I have experimented in my life also that when you change your tone, you know, when you are actually sounding that you really care for the child, when you're giving instruction with a logic to the current generation, they do understand. So this is something which I thought that I'll add up with that for the parents. And it was a wonderful session, Dr. Saab, and looking forward to meet you quite often. And I request all the parents, if you have still more queries, so kindly mail it to us and we'll send it across to Dr. Parikh and we'll get the answers from you. Yes? All right. So I believe that we are done for the day, and it was a wonderful meeting, Dr. Parikh.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much, sir. The strategies suggested by you are very useful, and I'm sure they will be helpful to many of us. As it is rightly said, you cannot control the wind, but you can adjust the sails. Thank you once again, sir, for coming here and addressing our parents. Thank you very much to the audience as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you.